So let us start the lecture. So I would like to begin from the background information explaining what this course is about and what would be necessary for assessment in particular. From very philosophical point of view, I wish to start from the role of mathematics in our picture of universe. And originally, mathematics was not split into pure and applied, and it was believed what mathematical construction
describe certain true relation in the surrounding world. In particular, geometry to be something which accurately represent our practice in measuring land or building some construction in space. And that was for a very long time until 19th century, when people working on the fifth postulate about parallel lines discovered Lobachevsky, Boyer, Gauss, discovered that actually there are other geometries which is not necessarily a Euclidean one. And then it was in particular information about geometry on flat surface or spherical surface or even hyperbolical surface was realized as logically possible and mathematically interesting. And in certain point, it was a bit of upset for people because mathematics a true picture of surrounding world, and it became much more like a game of mind, so mental exercise, where we may put forward arbitrary set of axioms and derive some logical consequences. And a variety of different geometries somehow was as a surprising environment in 19th century. And the places of these geometries in the mathematical knowledge need to be explained. And that came at some point from the work of Felix Klein and Sophus Lee. Mainly that achievement is contributed to Felix Klein and his inaugural lecture as professor at Erlangen University. But it was greatly influenced by Sophus Lee, who developed the theory of the group at that time and was in contact with Felix Klein. So Felix Klein proposed to classify geometry using the group theory. So let us briefly look at the connection of different fields of mathematics related to the geometry. So, in the same period of time, Riemann had introduced his approach to geometry based on calculus, on derivative infinitesimal distances. So, construction of geometry from global to global point of view, where we define infinitesimal metric tensor, which may be Riemannian or pseudo-Riemannian with definite sign, and then there are corresponding metric operator, Laplace-Beltrami operator. So if elliptic case, it will be the Laplacian operator, x squared, dy squared, and in pseudo-Riemannian case, we have a wave-type operator, which is dx squared minus dy squared. And it was very soon realized what geometrical construction require factorization of this operator in the first order differential operator and second order differential operator. For Laplacian, that was done by Cauchy-Riemann operators and require introduction of complex imaginary unit I squared equal to minus one. And for wave equation, we may potentially factorize wave operator itself without any imaginary unit, but to be in line with the previous construction, for some reason, it may be was to introduce hyperbolic unit, which is square root to 1, although it's not 1 or minus 1 itself, it's an imaginary unit, but it's square equal to 1, like with and then we got a factorization into kind of analytical equation. So we have our second order equation, excluding the parabolic one, so the heat equation, or that may be in complex situation with a Schrodinger equation. Then we have a second derivative in x and third derivative in y. We will try attempt to factorize it using some unit. Probably the right guess would be what the square of this unit shall be in the quiz between elliptic and hyperbolic value plus 1 and minus 1. Anything? Questions? Strange. Let me check my device. Just a second.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So it's hopefully the new batteries will work. All right, so in a parabolic case, when we have parabolic equation, one may try to put intermediate value, some imaginary unit, which square to zero, although it's not zero itself as a real number, and try to factorize in a similar way parabolic equation as we factorize Laplacian and wave equation. Technically, it does not work, at least it's this very plain setting. So we will come back to that issue later, but what I will try to say, what as you can see, a geometry, Riemannian geometry approach to the geometry, immediately has a connection to analytical function when we factorize Laplacian into Cauchy-Riemann operator, and it has application to physics and corresponding calculus of operator. So there is a bunch of topics which is connected to that geometrical, initially geometrical setup. So around the same time, Felix Klein come with the proposition and he defined a geometry as theory which investigate invariance under transitive group action on certain homogeneous space. That was a really remarkable proposition because the proper group theory was not developed so much at that time, and so it was a kind of insight which was ahead of its time. So unlike the Riemann geometry, which proposed a certain toolkit, analysis toolkit, which was quite developed in 19th century, so that proposition to treat geometry through the theory of group was not supported by developed group theory. And so that proposition was like a useful classification tool for geometries which would be developed somehow differently, using different approach. So in particular, people now can see that transition from the Euclidean geometry, which investigate angles, distances, and things like that, to affine geometry, which investigate the behavior of straight lines and where incidence, and then to the projective geometry, so on. So it's done by modification of corresponding group, where we add to the isometries of Euclidean play first the affine transformation and then projective transformation of the plane. So that classification allow from the group point of view just to put certain general picture on known results. And how was possible to come to the proposition of Felix Klein and what really Sophus Lee fought at that time. So that will be not much surprising if we will take a look on previous development of mathematics. First of all, the split between geometry and algebra was overcome by René Descartes, who proposed to treat geometrical question using coordinate method, and any geometrical question was reduced just to a certain set of algebraic equations. And when Galois in 19th century discovered what solvability of algebraic equation, of especially of higher order, is in close relation with certain symmetry groups. And then, of course, if you just combine with two ideas, then you can come to the conclusion what solvability of geometrical equation does depend from certain group of symmetries, so which of course common symmetries of the geometrical and algebraical form of that problem. So that is quite natural development of thoughts. And what that course about is what by now we have good development of the group theory, and especially we have good development of the representation theory of group, where group acts not only as transformation on certain sets in geometrical way, it also may be acting as a linear transformation on certain spaces of functions. Then we may use group theoretical methods to build interesting geometrical type theories in a very different setup. In mathematics, that somehow is not the first line technique. Typically, that ideas of symmetries and invariants, they are very useful in a physical setup. It's, for example, the theory of special relativity is defined to be as the physical theory invariant under Lorentz group of transformation of the Minkowski spacetime. So, and it's very common for a physical theory to start its construction from describing which invariants that theory should have. So in mathematics, it's not as much common, but it's still fruitful approach, and not only in the geometry, it will be demonstrated in this course for group theory and operator theory, so same approach work well. And now I wish to explain the structure of this course. In this course, we will be preoccupied just with one particular group, SL2R, which is a relatively simple group. It's not incredibly complicated in its construction, but it's rather rich in its structure and rather rich in consequences which can be obtained. So we will be working with SL2R group, and you may treat the course as the supplementary to the course on general theory of Lie group and Lie algebras. So some general result which you know may happen for Lie groups in general will be verified, tested, and used for that particular setup. So I will try to avoid that big theory of Lie groups at all, just I will make certain references where suitable. Instead of big theory, we always can use some particular calculations based on particular form of our group, so we may just directly verify certain general theorem in our special case. So that will put us down to the earth in that course. Also, the course is not the core course in terms of magic. In core courses, certain big theory, important theory is covered, and students are expected to learn that theory, essentially all elements of it. My course is like a supplementary course where I am producing certain illustration to core material. So what I would like you learn from this course is not particular facts, and you don't need to memorize much of particular facts, but I would like you somehow share with me a general belief what SL2R is useful in many fields. So at some point of your research career, you may find what SL2R may be useful in your field as well. So based on example which you will see. And that will be very good from my point of view. I will achieve my target if that happens. So for the purpose of assessment, I will not request you to learn all facts or theorems which we mentioned here. They are rather illustrations for that general idea. And for assessment, you will be asked to make some relatively simple, straightforward exercises, which provide some rather basic, not too much advanced result about SL2R. So that if at some point you will feel what there is too many facts in that course, so you shall not worry what you need to memorize and understand all of them. So rather you shall get a particular impression of what SL2R is useful. So that is my main topic which I try to convince you during the course. And then we will structure of the course is as follow. We will start from some basic facts about SL2R and what how we can decompose it into smaller subgroups and how SL2R acts on corresponding homogeneous spaces. When we develop certain geometry based on that facts, so I hope you will see something interesting and new for you in that construction. So the main purpose again, what it everything will be developed in the language in the spirit of Erlangen program. So it will be just consequences of the structure SL2R and some basic facts. When we move to representation of SL2R in some vector spaces, in the spaces of functions, and that will lead us to the theory of analytical function and its possible generalization or analogous which work not only for elliptic case but for parabolic and hyperbolic as well. And we will finish about some topics related to application of SL2R to operator theory and quantization. Any questions so far? All right, so let's move to the mathematical subject of that course. So we are starting from the definition, what is SL2R? Initially, you take it as a group consisting of 2 times 2 matrices with real entries. So A, B, C, D, arranged as a square, and that collection of elements is restricted by the condition what determinant of this matrix is equal to 1. We introduce group operation as matrix multiplication. We multiply 2 matrices. That will be the group law. Because determinant of a product of 2 matrices is equal to the product of determinants, clearly that operation is closed on the SL2R. And we may calculate dimensionality of SL2R as the three-dimensional manifold, because we have in general 4 real parameters A, B, C, D, and 1 restricting condition what A, D minus B, C is equal to 1. So 4 minus 1 is 3-dimensional set of our parameters. There is no simple way to give that or very plain way to give that parameterization in terms of just three parameters, not four with one condition. And the reason for that, again, geometrical, if you will look for possible pictures, what collection of sets, what collection, what set may parameterize SL2R. So the best picture is probably provided by a torus, the solid one, not only surface of torus, but three-dimensional object, which is connected, but not simply connected, represent the group SL2R in set theoretical object. Then the important property which we will use on many occasions, what SL2R, not just a group, it is a Lie group. Its operation, multiplication, is smooth, analytical, even analytical in terms of its parameter. If you multiply two matrices, the product smoothly depends from coefficients which you are multiplying, and that analytical properties will be essentially used in many cases. So if we are speaking about the group, we of course need have an identity elements here, and because we are multiplying matrices, the identity element of course will be identity matrix, and inverse element for the matrix of course easy to calculate. It's a matrix D minus B minus CA for matrix ABCD. So again, multiplication and property what determinant is equal to 1 shows what we get identity matrix as a product. SL2R is three-dimensional, it's rather simple, but it's somehow simplest example of non-simple thing. So it's a non-commutative group, so non-commutative groups, matrix multiplication is non-commutative, so this group is non-commutative, and that group is also non-compact. So this is important property, a topological one, because for compact groups, say a group of rotation of unit sphere or something like that, representation theory and some other property are much simpler. And for SL2R, that things much more interesting, much more tricky. So SL2R in that respect, although being just three-dimensional, present a very good starting point for a lot of big theories. In particular, SL2R is the simplest example of semi-simple Lie group. That means what in terms of Lie algebra, there are no other ideals which are not trivial, so besides zero and the entire group. And there are big theory of semi-simple Lie group where SL2R is present just a very important fundamental example. Furthermore, SL2R has certain other faces, other groups, classical groups, are completely isomorphic to SL2R. So this is group SU22 of complex matrices. We will come to that phase when we will speak about geometry of the unit disk, or it can be treated as a group of Lorentz type transformation in Minkowski space with two dimensions and space dimension and one time dimension. So in that respect, it's maybe again treated as a simple group for special relativity type theory. So again, SL2R has that physical significance because we can model, test certain physical concept, relativity concept using SL2R. But we mainly work with SL2R phase of this group, and that two or more other phases will be mentioned in suitable places very briefly. Again, if we are working with the Lie group, the first step, of course, would be to identify corresponding Lie algebra. So that infinitesimal object which associated to the Lie group and which really helped to study Lie group in great details. There are several canonical ways how to associate Lie algebra to a Lie group. So you may think about Lie algebra as being a tangent space at identity, tangent space to the group manifold, or another way to think about it is to be generators of one parameter continuous semigroup. So continuous semigroup just a group homomorphism of real numbers into our Lie group. So group homomorphism means that highlighted property. And example of such one parameter continuous group, subgroup of SL2R will be 2×2 matrices built on of the trigonometric function cosine, sine, minus sine, cosine t. Just known trigonometric identities, if you multiply two such matrices, one with parameter t, another with parameter s, and you use trigonometric identity, you will obtain again matrix of this form where parameter is t plus s. So this is one example, and we see this example very oftenly when we consider SL2R, and we will see some other example of one parameter semigroup. We will shortly classify all one parameter continuous groups within SL2R. When we can calculate having a semigroup or one parameter subgroup, we can calculate its derivative with respect to parameter t using the semigroup property. So when in that difference for derivative, we split g of t plus s as a product of gt and gs. When gt is a common factor, we put it here, and when it's turned out what we only need to calculate the limit from this fraction. So we need to calculate limit of this fraction that independent from a point t and independent of anything really of the limit. So that is certain constant element. If we will do such calculation for SL2R, where elements of our group, again, there are some general theory of Lie group, but in our case, we consider one particular example, so that calculation can be done just with 2×2 matrices. And when we are doing that calculation, we will find out what X, in our case, would be a matrix with zero trace. And that matrix, in fact, generate our subgroup. It's generate in the sense what it is a solution of the following differential equation. That, again, very basic first-order differential equation. And in abstract sense, a solution to this general differential equation would be an exponent function. So if using the formula for derivative of exponent, we formally satisfy that equation. But to act less formally, we may think what that exponent is simply represented by such infinite series, which is Taylor expansion of exponent function. So we do such Taylor expansion. When formal derivative, if we will interchange the order of summation and derivation, assuming we can do that, demonstrate that we indeed have the solution of our differential equation. When in our special case, we don't need to do very difficult task to making sense of that expression, infinite series and powers of xn. Our elements are 2×2 matrices. and we may simply calculate powers multiplying corresponding number of matrices, and when convergence of a series is defined in term of point wise convergence, that means every entry of our matrix in the series shall converge to the limit. So this is again for that particular case can be checked based on rather straightforward calculus. No high theory is required to verify what matrix can be, one parameter subgroup can be generated by a zero trace matrix. So the relation between trace and determinant ensure what whenever our X is zero trace matrix, when exponent of Tx will be matrix with unit determinant. Then, as it usual happened with the Lie group, for Lie algebra, we need to define the operation of commutator. So for generators of semigroup, we need to define that commutator. Somehow it's beyond not seen this moment. So we define the commutator of two vectors xy as xy minus yx. Again, in our particular case, when we have matrices, we just don't need to go to high theory. That expression shall be understood as operation on matrices. We multiply matrix x to matrix y and subtract the product of y to x. It's again a matter to verify by a very simple calculation, very straightforward. Whenever we have two zero trace matrices x and y, commutator will be again the zero trace matrices. So commutator is a closed operation on the corresponding Lie algebra. Next topic, again rather general, which happened not only for SL to R, that will be action of a group on homogeneous spaces. As you remember, according to the Klein definition, geometry is study of invariance under transitive group action. So a group G may potentially act on any vector space, group G can act on some geometrical set X as certain transformation. And we may watch out orbits of particular points, so take a point and apply all possible transformation to that point, then we will obtain what is called orbit. On an orbit, our group act transitively. That means any point can be transferred to any other point. An entire space X is decomposed into disjoint union of such orbits. So because there is no interaction between different orbits, whenever you apply your group, you always stay on the same orbit. We may simply limit our investigation to one particular orbit. When you know and you understand action of your group on any possible orbit, when any other space is just collection of such orbits, so you just need to know which orbit you need to make a union to build your space. So what we will do next, we decompose our space X into such a union of the orbit, and further we restrict our attention only to such homogeneous spaces where our group is acting transitively on entire space. Now let's again come to such an orbit, take a particular point X and apply all possible transformation. So what we told before, what we can arrive to any other point from point X by means of such transformation, this is one fact. But another fact, what some transformation may leave our point in place. I think, for example, if you have Euclidean motion of a plane or you have rotation of the plane, then center of the rotation is a fixed point. So it stays on the place while other points are moving. So for every point, there is a collection of element of the group which leave that point in place. By the definition, it's easy to check what collection of such elements form a subgroup. Clearly, identity element which fix all points of the space, it's fix our given point X. And when you have the two such transformation and apply them in the sequence, then the product will be again element which fixed our point, and inverse, of course, will be if transformation leave our point in place, then inverse transformation leave that point in place. So this is a subgroup. So having a homogeneous space, every point define certain subgroup which called isotropy subgroup of that point. If you instead of point X take another point Y and calculate isotropy subgroup for that point, relation with the isotropy subgroup with X, this will be just conjugation. So that will be two conjugated subgroup within G. So that tells what it's an if doesn't matter which point you choose, because any other isotropy subgroup will be simply conjugated. So this is a general consideration for any group. And again, for any group, we may produce certain examples of action which by which a group act on itself. And one of such action is conjugation, when an element of the group is conjugated by another element. When, of course, if our group is commutative one, that action is trivial. So any point X or any element of the group under conjugation remain in place. So that is kind of action which is of interest only for non-commutative group, and our SL2R is not commutative, so conjugation will play interesting role there. And there are also so-called shifts, left shift when we multiply by G on the left, and right shift where we multiply by minus G on the right. So minus G power inverse of G is necessary with multiplication on the right, because we want to be that shifts to make a group homomorphism from G to transformation group. And left and right shift, in fact, they are similar in the sense what there is an inversion. So if you take send an element G to inverse element, then that action intertwine two action, left shift and right shift. So that two actions will be again considered very often. So summing up on this slide, we are saying what whenever we have a homogeneous space where our group act transitively, then we are effectively picking up certain isotropy subgroup which is defining, which is defined by such homogeneous spaces. We may proceed in the opposite direction as well. We may start from certain subgroup and then build corresponding homogeneous space. So let's do it again in general setup. We take a group G and H to be a certain subgroup. Then we can introduce the equivalence relation on the group G by the this identity for certain element of subgroup H. So that means by action on the right, by element of the subgroup, all elements of subgroup H, we obtain an equivalence class, cosets. When cosets with respect to wet equivalence relation are preserved. That means what if we act by the left shift on the collection of if we act by left shift on the group, then elements from one cassette are transformed to elements again of some other cassettes. But they will, that equivalence relation is preserved by left shifts. And that is easy to see just because left and right shift commute with each other. In a sense, the cassettes are defined by right shifts by from the subgroup H. So left shift does not break that equivalence relation. So that collection of cosets is easy to see is a homogeneous space. Whenever we have that collection of cosets, action by left shift of our group is transitive. So that correspondence between subgroups of G and homogeneous spaces is one-to-one. Whenever you have homogeneous space, you obtain the fixed group, isotropy subgroup for the corresponding point, or if you start from a subgroup, you build the corresponding homogeneous space of cosets. So that is useful to remember what relation of homogeneous spaces and subgroups. Then, whenever we have cosets, as you know, it's useful technique to operate is to parameterize them. So, and we will parameterize the element of cosets G over H in terms of certain continuous section, because we are working on continuous group, we want that section to be continuous from a collection of cosets to the group. That means for each coset, we pick up one representative, one element in that coset from the group, which will represent this coset. And we, when in this case, we have a natural projection which put element of G into corresponding cosets, and S will be the right inverse to that natural projection P. It will be clearly not the left inverse, it's only the right inverse for that natural projection P. Then furthermore, we, the difference if we apply S and P in opposite way, so if we will consider composition of S and P, then as a result, we do not get typically G itself, but what we will take, we will take element from the same coset, because we first project element to the coset and then pick up its representative, so it will be a certain element from the same coset. If it's element from the same coset, it shall be in the form G times H for certain H in our subgroup. So that lead to the decomposition. So a general element of our group G can be split into two parts. One is SP part of G and R remainder, which can be calculated as element of H. We will not bother with this remainder in the first geometrical part of our course. We mainly work with S and P maps in geometrical part, of course. That reminder R will be very crucial later in the second and third part when we will build induced representation, linear representation of our group, where that R reminder will be recalled again out of the group. So probably just a couple of minutes finish this lecture. Let's look initially how that construction general discussion which we had before applied to our particular situation. So the, we have subgroup SL2R of 2 times 2 matrices, and we want to classify all its subgroups, continuous one, with the aim to consider corresponding homogeneous spaces, because groups produce homogeneous spaces, and action of a group on homogeneous spaces lead to certain geometry in the sense of Erlangen program. So if we will consider two-dimensional subgroup of SL2R, this is a group of upper or lower triangular matrices, or any conjugated to such, well, actually upper and lower triangular matrices are conjugated to each other. Effectively, we have only one, essentially one subgroup here. And that subgroup itself is rather remarkable. It's called group of affine transformation of a real line, AX plus B group. And a lot of result in harmonic analysis on the real line, in fact, can be deduced from the property in the same spirit as we are working with SL2R, so working with AX plus B group, subgroup of SL2R, it's possible to obtain a lot of results of harmonic analysis. And if we will think about parameterization of that upper subgroup, so A here is a positive real, and B is just a real. So geometrically, that subgroup A, AX plus B, is parameterized by the upper half plane. And again, there is a significance for that AX plus B parameterization by upper half plane, because in a sense of extended Erlangen program, it's lead to analytical function theory, to complex analysis. And there are collection of examples here, A and K, of one parameter subgroup, just one dimensional subgroup of SL2R, which of course we know are generated by the traceless matrices, as we discussed before. So here that subgroup A and K are represented as exponents of certain traceless matrices from the correspondingly algebra. Here is an example. But that examples, in a sense, exhaustive. We will see what any one parameter continuous subgroup of SL2R, in fact, is conjugated similar to either A, N, or K. But that will be probably the topic of the next lecture next week. So thank you very much for your attention. Any questions? Well, I don't think so. I'm not ready to do it right now, but I think it's possible to make a covering of it, present a sequence of elements from SL2R which is not convergent to a matrix. So I think it's possible without accumulating points. Yeah, so if you put it as my homework assignment, I will come next lecture with the answer. More questions? All right, hope to see you next week.